Good morning.
Good morning.
I wish you each a blessed rest in Christ.
Chuck, get your mic off or mute.
I will turn it on. That might help.
Okay.
How's that?
Better.
Due to unforeseen circumstances, your pastor is not able to be here today, so yesterday afternoon, about 4:30, I was asked to take this service. What I've prepared, I hope, will be a blessing to everyone present.
Amen.
I want to begin my remarks by asking you what I believe is the most important question that can be asked, not of all Christians, but of Seventh-day Adventists. Here's the question. How many of you want for Jesus to return within your lifetime?
Amen.
All heaven smiled at those of you that responded in a positive way. Because I personally believe that Jesus raised the Seventh-day Adventist Church to prepare a people to be alive when He comes. Today, unfortunately, in all Christian churches, and tomorrow, most people are being prepared to be resurrected when Jesus comes. Here's another question. How many of you own a television set? How many of you get more than one channel on your television set? When you turn your television on, do you do it by physically going and pressing a button, or do you use a remote control? Heaven also has a television set. But Heaven's television set is a little bit different than our television set. Heaven's television set only gets one channel. And Heaven's television set does not have an off button. So it would be useless for them to have a remote control. When you and I see something on television that we do not like or we shouldn't watch, we get our remote control and change channels, or we turn the television off. But when Heaven sees something on this earth that is not pleasant, murders, the molestation of children, they cannot change channels, and they cannot turn it off. The only program that Heaven can watch is called Life on Planet Earth. And they've been watching it for 6,000 years. Another reason that Heaven's television set only has one channel and does not have an off button is because every thought, word, and act of every member of the human race from Adam and Eve until Jesus returns the second time must be recorded. Let me read it to you if you'd like to look it up. Follow me. Revelation chapter 20, verse 12. Revelation chapter 20, verse 12. Revelation 20, verse 12. And I saw the dead, the great and the small, standing before the throne, and books, plural, were open. And another book, singular, was open, which is the book, singular, of life. And the dead were judged from the things which were written in the books according to their deeds. The author of the book, Desire of Ages, makes a very interesting statement regarding this topic on page 313. Quote, "All who choose Christ's kingdom of love and righteousness and peace, making its interest above all other interests, are linked to the world above, and every blessing needed for this life is theirs. In the book of God's providence, the volume of life, we are each given an individual page, That page contains every detail of our history. Even the hairs of our head are numbered. God's children are never absent from His mind. End quote. The book of Revelation promises a blessing to anyone that reads it. And those that cannot read are promised a blessing if they're willing to listen. Remember Revelation 1:3? Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and guard, cherish, protect, appreciate those things which are written therein. The book of Revelation is known as a prophetic book because it's speaking of last day events. That's why it's known as the apocalypse. The topic that I want to focus on this morning is the spiritual condition that will bring Jesus' return, or will make Jesus' return possible, and how Jesus wants for each one of us to prepare for that coming, which means preparing to be alive when Jesus returns. The reason that I say spiritual condition is because most Christians believe that what will trigger Jesus' second coming are events on this earth, like tsunamis, earthquakes, hurricanes, the pollution in the air, the contamination of the water, global warming, the economy, and now most recently, terrorist acts. Scripture, however, makes it very clear that it is a spiritual condition experienced by a certain group of people that will make it possible for Jesus to return the second time. If you're still in Revelation, turn to your left from chapter 20 to chapter 19, and I'll read two verses for you. Revelation 19, verses 7 and 8. Let us rejoice and be glad and give the glory to Him. For the marriage of the Lamb has come, and His bride has made herself ready. Verse 8. And it was given to her to clothe herself in fine linen, bright and clean, for the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints. Which means that this gospel of the kingdom cannot be preached in all the world as a witness unto all nations until the bride has made herself ready. The righteousness of Jesus qualifies the bride to become a reliable witness. As Jesus says to his disciples, in a verse that all of you know, Matthew 24:14, this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached as a witness to all the world. And then and only then can the end come. The word witness being used here is a legal term. It's speaking of a human being that has a pulse and has heard or seen something that has changed their mindset. They have made a U-turn from the direction that they were going in, and now they have chosen to make a commitment to Christ. Once Jesus has a people on this earth that have made that U-turn and made that commitment, have subordinated themselves to the will of God, then something very interesting can happen. The latter rain can be poured out. Until the latter rain is poured out, there is no witnessing to the world. In Revelation 18, 1 through 4, we learn that someday, when the latter rain is poured out, a great light and power will be given to those that are preparing themselves to be alive when Jesus comes. And then, verse 4 can become a reality in Revelation 18. You've heard of the third angel's message, the three angels' message. Revelation 14, 6 and 19. But there is a fourth angel. And now the fourth angel speaks in Revelation 18, 4. It says, and I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues. That cannot happen until the latter rain is poured out on a people that are focused on being alive when Jesus comes, and not being resurrected. One of the founders of Seventh-day Adventist Church made a profound statement in 1892 about the specific topics that those people that are being preparing themselves to be alive when Jesus comes should be proclaiming to the world. It's a very brief statement. This is the statement. Justification by faith and the righteousness of Christ are the themes to be proclaimed to a perishing world. That's registered in Letter 24, 1892, and in Volume 7 of the Bible Commentary, page 964. Revelation 2 and 3 are the chapters known as the message to the seven churches. Jesus, in the message to the seven churches in Revelation 2 and 3, is evaluating the spiritual condition of the people that claim to be Christians and that believe in God. Jesus uses our works to evaluate the spiritual condition. Remember what Jesus said in Matthew 5, 14 and 16? Let me read it to you. Quote, "You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden." Verse 16. "Let your," plural, "light," singular, "shine before men in such a way that they may see your good works and glorify" who? Your Father, which is in heaven. So we reveal our spiritual condition based on our works. So even though works does not save anyone, works is the evidence of the spiritual condition that God's people must experience. As all of you know, Revelation, the book of Revelation, has a lot of symbols. And unfortunately, we well-meaning human beings like to put our interpretation on all of these symbols. That's a big mistake. So let's go to Scripture and see how Jesus evaluates the spiritual condition of the last church in Revelation chapter 3, known as the Laodicean Church, which symbolically applies to each one of us today. Now let's turn to the left, to chapter 3 of Revelation. Revelation chapter 3. I'm enjoying the breeze that these fans generate, but it's a challenge to keep these pages in one place. Revelation chapter 3, beginning with verse 16. "I know your deeds." Some versions say, "I know your works, that you are neither cold or hot. I wish that you were cold or hot." 16. "So because you are lukewarm and neither hot or cold, I feel like vomiting you out of my mouth." Traditionally, the Christian world, and unfortunately us as a denomination, have interpreted the word lukewarm as complacency or mixing hot and cold. So, let's go to Scripture and learn the biblical meaning of cold, hot, and lukewarm. Keep going to the left, and we're now going to go to Revelation chapter 1, verse 20. Revelation chapter 1, verse 20, the last verse. Thank you. Revelation chapter 1, verse 20. "As for the mystery of the seven stars which you saw in my right hand and the seven golden lampstands, the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches." Let's begin by identifying what the angel is saying here. The angel is not a physical being from heaven. But rather a messenger, someone that holds an office, a position of responsibility. It could be a Sabbath school teacher, a Sabbath school superintendent, an elder, a deacon. Primarily, it applies to the ministers of the church. In Revelation 3:14, we learn who is addressing the message to the seventh church. We can now flip back to chapter 3 of Revelation, verse 14. This is the introduction to the Laodicea message. And to the angel of the church in Laodicea write, the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God, says this. The word Amen can be used as a proper noun right here. The word actually means, so be it. The truth. Jesus is saying, I am the Amen. I am the truth. I, says Jesus, am the faithful and true witness. You should remember that. Because Jesus said to us in Matthew 24:14, this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world as a witness. So is he asking me to do something that he has not done? Or how is he asking me to do it? We're going to come to that later. In every one of the messages to the seven churches in Revelation 2 and 3, Jesus identifies himself with a different title. The different titles reflect the needs of each of these churches. The last title that Jesus uses for Laodicea is, I am the beginning of the creation of God. This word beginning has caused problems in the Christian world, including the pioneers of our church. Because some people actually believe and teach that Jesus had a beginning. Jesus is a created being. In fact, some teach that Jesus is the first creation of God. So let's go to Scripture and get very clearly in our minds whether Jesus is a created being or not. I invite you to turn to John chapter 1. John, New Testament, John chapter 1. I'm going to read the first three verses for you. John chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. I hear leaves flipping, so I will wait until you get there. This is crucial that we be very clear as to whether Jesus had a beginning or not, whether he's a created being or not. John chapter 1, beginning with verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Verse 2. He was in the beginning with God. 3. All things came into being by him, and apart from him, nothing came into being that has come into being. So the grammar and the context is very clear here. Jesus has existed from the beginning. Nothing was created without him creating it. So it's impossible for him to have created himself. Can we agree on that? Now let's turn to our right, to another passage. Colossians chapter 1, very, very important topic, very important scripture. Colossians chapter 1, verses 16 and 17. You ready? Colossians 1, verses 16 and 17. For by him all things were created, both in the heavens and on the earth, visible and invisible. For the thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things have been created by him and for him. Verse 17. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. The important thing to understand here is that in the Greek language, the New Testament, the word beginning does not mean a starting point. The word beginning means the source, the origin, the cause of something happening. We're talking grammar here. What Jesus is saying to Laodicea is, I am not only the true witness, But I am the source of all creation. I am the solution to your challenges in life. That is why Jesus gives himself these different titles. A clear understanding of Revelation 3, 15, and 16 is crucial in understanding the message to the last church of Revelation 3, the Laodicean church. And here is the key. Verse 15, four words. I know your works. What does that mean? The word works is being used here to describe behavior, individual behavior. Jesus is not talking about our denomination's medical work all over the world and our educational system. No. He's speaking of the individual behavior, the spiritual condition. Because if the spiritual condition is wrong, then my behavior, my motivation for my behavior, my works are not acceptable to God.
Amen.
So the issue in the Laodicean message is not a lack of works. Jesus does not say in Revelation 3:15, I am writing to you because you have a few good works, you're just not doing enough. It doesn't say that. Jesus makes it very clear in part 1 of verse 15, I know what you're doing. I know your works. So, why is Jesus saying, I know your works? Then he continues in verse 15 by saying that our works are neither hot, cold, but lukewarm. The New Testament describes human behavior in three categories. Works of the flesh, works of faith, and works of the law. Jesus and the New Testament writers label works of the flesh as cold works. Because when the word flesh is used in the New Testament, the spiritual context of it refers to my carnal, fallen, sinful nature. I want to read it to you word for word, and if you have a Bible and you have the interest, I want for you to turn right now to Galatians, book of Galatians, chapter 5, and we're going to read the description of cold works. What my sinful carnal nature produces all by itself. This is the way I wake up every morning, including Sabbath. And if I don't have help from outer space, you're going to see the results. Galatians chapter 5, three verses, 19, 20, and 21. Now the works, or the deeds, of the flesh are evident, which are immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, outbursts of anger, disputes, dissensions, factions, continuing, same sentence, verse 21, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and things like these, of which I forewarn you, just as I have forewarned you, that those who practice such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. The word sin here can also be used as missing the mark. Sincerity, sincere people that don't understand what we're studying here and the significance of it. Missing the mark. Why should we identify the works of the flesh as cold? Stay in Galatians. Stay in Galatians. Let me read it to you, what Jesus said in Matthew 24. All of you are familiar with verse 14. I'm going to read verse 12 to you. Where do we get the definition of cold? It's Jesus' idea. Matthew 24, 12. And because lawlessness is increased, most people's love will grow cold. So if you believe that Jesus is a reliable source, here we have a clear identification of labeling the works of the flesh as cold works. What is the opposite of cold? Hot. What is the opposite of works of the flesh?
Spirit.
Works of the spirit or works of the faith. You still in Galatians chapter 5? Let's read verses 22 and 23. But the fruit of the Spirit is what? love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such, God's word has no problem. God's law is in complete agreement with those nine blessings of justification by faith. So there are two kinds of walks. You can choose to walk in the flesh, which produces full works, or you can choose to walk in the Spirit. If you chose to walk in the Spirit, as Jesus did when he was on this earth, what results does Jesus guarantee in your life? Galatians 5:16. You shall not fulfill the lusts of the flesh. The fruits of the Spirit, however, are synonymous with the works of faith. As Jesus tells us in John 14:12. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he and she shall do also. Do you like that? So if we choose to abide in Christ by faith, what did I do?
Spook. No.
So if you choose to abide in Christ by faith, as Jesus admonishes his disciples to in John 15:4-5, Jesus guarantees works of faith in each one of us. Do you like guarantees?
Amen.
Especially those from Jesus? If cold is the works of the flesh, then lukewarm would have to be the works of the law. Let me read to you the dramatic contrast that the Apostle Paul makes between works of the faith and works of the law. I'm now going to go to the left from Galatians. We're going to go to Romans chapter 9. This is a passage that you are familiar with, but I want for you to associate what the Apostle Paul is doing here in comparing the works of faith with works of the law. Romans 9, 30, 31, and 32. Are we ready? Romans 9, 30. What shall we say then? That Gentiles who did not pursue righteousness attained righteousness, even the righteousness which is by faith? But Israel, pursuing a law of righteousness, did not arrive at that law. Why? Because they did not pursue it by faith, but as though it were by works. They stumbled over the stumbling stone. The English term that defines the biblical expression, my own works, or works of the law, is self-righteousness, motivated by what Jesus identifies as lukewarm. We read it already in Revelation 3:16. So here's the dilemma that Jesus faces with his bride elect. That's you and me. Do the works of the law go to church on Sabbath? Yes. Do the works of faith go to church on Sabbath?
Yes.
Of course. The issue then is not whether we are going to church on the right day of the week, Sabbath, but rather how. What is the motivation for me being here today? Is it works of the law? Or is it works of faith? Works of the law are not the same as works of the flesh. Works of the flesh are out and out sinful acts. I just read it to you, Galatians 5. 19, 20, and 21. While works of the law are sinful acts. Works of the law on the surface are righteous in appearance. They look good, but they're very deceiving because they are self-righteous in motivation. Regarding self-righteousness, a very perceptive writer said, your self-righteousness is nauseating to the Lord Jesus Christ. Manuscript 108, 1899. And that is exactly what Jesus is saying to the seventh church, the Laodicean church, in Revelation 3:16. Jesus is faced with a major problem. in our church, the Laodicean church. If we were hot, we would be happy. He would be happy. Because hot works are produced by the Holy Spirit through individuals that have subordinated their will to Jesus. If we were cold in our works, Jesus could deal with that. Yes? Remember Romans 6:16?